Hey guys, how are you all doing? A very warm welcome to round 7 it is already of the Ziggo Pro League Championship. After Monaco, of course, where we scored a consistent and a solid third place, really. We want to carry that momentum forwards now into this iconic track, really, into this iconic round of the season. Final qualifying lap that we are going to do here. We've currently got a 107.6 on the board, and really, that needs to be better. After the last round, though, Jarno Opmeer claimed the lead in the championship. But pay attention, of course, to P10, Roy Arnouts, because he won his first race ever in this league. So those two are obviously interesting to have a look at. Our teammate is also back for this round, so that's definitely a good thing. But like I said, last lap of this qualifying session, I've got a 107.6 on the board, but really it needs to be better. You really want to be low sevens, and that is possible, to be honest. I expect a minimal at least of a 107.3, and anything slower than a 107.3 would actually be pretty damn disappointing. Now we have got our teammate behind us in the house, of course. And I saw that, so once I noticed that, I wanted to give him a little bit of slipstream, of course, down the straight, as he is our teammate, and I've actually got a really good bond with him, like a really good racing connection between the two of us. So he's a good guy, so why not give him a bit of slipstream before we start our lap ourselves. Here we are then, 30 seconds to go in qualifying, once again the final lap that we're gonna do. So let's have a look at what it's gonna be like. First second then, pretty tricky. You want to carry a lot of speed at this one, of course, but not too much, as it can compromise that right hand, that very slow right hand. They're going to first gear really there for a moment in order to get the front end to rotate a bit better. But you know, this first second not really all that good. I should have carried more speed, especially coming into that that fast right left chicane. Obviously a lot of chicanes around this track. Tire wear, well, I mean, it's a bit interesting in the first stint, but other than that, it's fine, to be honest. But currently down on our 107.6, and that is not good. Getting a bit of time here, but then touching the wall next hit. So pretty scruffy once again, and despite it, we gained a bit of time, but not much. We're only half a tenth up, so it looks like this might be a pretty damn disappointing lap. And then also the hairpin, I'm not taking a good line through there. The exit is very poor. You can see the delta on the top right of the screen is tumbling down. And that hairpin probably is the most important corner on the track, and you kind of want to go quite deep into there. And I didn't do that at all. I really stuck to the inside of the corner, and you kind of want to take a V-line through there, which is the fastest way. And because of that, we have only been able to improve, but you know, by 600th of a second. So we're still having that 107.6, and it is incredibly disappointing, to be honest, because you can see Dominic over Dijking. He has had an amazing qualifying, put himself up into P3, but he has got that 107.3 lap time, and that's exactly what I was talking about. That should be my absolute minimal lap time. I'm able to do low sevens, but for some reason it just didn't come out really during this qualifying. Honestly, that's very scruffy, that is very poor, but what can you do? You again need to focus on the race. I said before, qualifying is not all that important compared to the race, but of course, because of Dominic over Dijking right now on our left-hand side, we do need to, you know, deal with him first before we can attack the top two. And as always, Jarno Opmeer and Roy Arnouts, like we saw last round, they have got the top two positions claimed. Start of the race then, a pretty good start on the outside of Dominic over Dijking already. This will be the inside line coming into turn three, but Dominic being really, really smart there and squeezing us quite a lot there on apex, on the apex, which was very smart. Because of that, I couldn't carry a lot of exit touching the wall there a bit. So Dominic over Dijking able to stay in front of us for the time being. We've got our teammate behind, by the way, in P5. You can see at the bottom quite a few people actually. We have, you know, retired already in this race. I think there was something like a 4, 5, 6 car incident after the fast right left chicane in the first sector. A famous corner, of course, or a famous chicane I should say, because of the Vettel Hamilton incident that we have seen roughly 2 weeks ago. But nonetheless, able to keep P4 for the time being. But you know, this is exactly what I was gonna say. Dominic having an excellent qualifying, but I honestly did not expect him to be right at the front after maybe 5, 6, 7-ish laps. I expected him to drop off a little bit. I mean, if I'm wrong, then I'm sure he will prove me wrong. And so far he is proving me wrong, but obviously it is only at the end of lap 1, so it's not really relevant to make any kind of conclusions for the time being. But because Dominic is there, you know, there's obviously a car in between us and the top two. And we know how fast those top two guys are. I mean, they are really the benchmark in this league. We saw that in Monaco, Jarno Holmeer and Roy Arnouts. They are both incredibly fast, both racing for, I think Roy is racing for Williams and Jarno is for Renault. If I'm wrong, then I'm sure someone will tell me. But they are racing in the official F1 Esports series, of course. They're very tough challengers, very, very tough opponents. But as you can see here, Dominic already losing a little bit of connection to that top two, making a bit of a mistake here in the hairpin as well. So we might be able actually to make a move, and that is actually going to be important. We want to get by Dominic Overdijk as soon as possible. DRS not yet enabled, of course, as it's the end of lap two. Next lap DRS will be enabled, but maybe we can already overtake with the use of some ERS, some slipstream looking on the inside. They're not going to make a move though. It seemed to make Dominic a little bit nervous there, coming on the entry of the fast right left chicane. Once again, overtake mode, Rich Mixer will be heading down into turn two. This is turn one, and here we go, turn two, once again on the outside, just like we saw in the first lap. But it seems like, yeah, once again still side by side, but it seems like we are this time far enough alongside to actually make that move work. And there we are, then up into P3, but look at the gap that we have obviously got now to the top two. So we've got some work to do here, able to get by Dominic Overdijk without the use of DRS, that's the one I should be referring to. So good move really on the outside there. I mean, it's pretty, well, I wouldn't say easy to do it there on the outside, but it obviously helps that turn three, touching the wall there on entry, it's obviously handy that turn three is a right-hander, because when you are on the outside of turn two, you will have the inside line for the next corner, and obviously that makes the chances of an overtake quite a lot bigger. So there we are then able to get by, and we'll see what we can do now to the top two. Dominic still being close though, has a bit of a scruffy lap really, this third lap. This is really something I need to improve on, because once I got past Dominic Overdijk, you immediately want to, you know, create a little bit of a gap. And I think if Dominic wanted to attack me, but he chose wisely not to do that, which is probably a good decision. And there we are then. 2 seconds off the top two, opening of lap four, the start of lap four. Currently doing a 1:12.6, so relatively alright. But you can see here at the end of lap 11, starting lap 12, we've got a 1:12.1 on the board, and currently we are doing 1:12.4. And that is not really a bad lap time, really, if you consider the tire condition, the state of the tires. In the meantime, our teammate also got by Dominic Overdijking, so he is now in P4, but not really able to close the gap really towards us. And if you remember, the gap before was 2 seconds to the top two, it is now 1.7, so we are actually making up a bit of ground here at the end of the first stint. But what we are seeing here is really a replay of what has been happening before, at least what I feel like has been happening before. We have had many races where we are very fast in the first stint. Why are we fast? I think we are pretty damn alright at you know, conserving the tires and tire management in general. But then, once you put on a fresh tire, which is usually a harder compound than the compound you start on, of course, the problems for, in this case, Opmeer and Arnouts, they disappear. You know, they don't have that problem really, where they have to save the tires. You do have to save the tires, I mean, you can't go blind on them, that's for sure. But managing the harder compound is much, much easier than managing that softer compound. Lap 13 then, our teammate has pitted, so he is going for an undercut. We'll be interested to see what he can do. I think I want to respond to him, so that would mean that we will be pitting in this lap. The scheduled pit stop is in lap 14, I believe. I think that's really when the pit window is open. At least the pit window is open already, but lap 14 would be the preferable lap to stop the car and put a new set of tires on them. This is a 3-stop race, by the way. This is a 2-stop race. So after this, we will be putting on the ultra soft, and then once again the ultra soft. But those ultra softs, once again, they, you know, you can manage them quite all right. We're losing a bit of time here, by the way, on this in lap to Jan Wolfman, making a bit of a mistake here in this happen as well. I pushed quite hard there in the, I think, last two laps, and I pushed a little bit too hard. And really, that is again, that tire management. You need to feel how much you can push, really. And if you go over the limit once, like you saw that slide there in that hairpin, it will immediately make those tires a lot warmer, a lot hotter. And it will be very tricky really to control the car. And because of that, you slide even more. And because of that, the tires heat up even more. So it's like a little bit of a cycle really, where you end up in when you, you know, don't really manage those tires. You really want to be stable, solid, and it will probably not make you faster over one lap, but it will make you faster over a stint, because your tires are in a better shape over the course of the stint. So that first stint was actually quite promising. I saw that gap closing to the top two, which is exactly what we wanted. But now again, you know, we put on the Ultrasoft. We want to have a look at how well we can do another Ultrasoft. By the way, staying ahead of our teammate was no problem whatsoever, but we will be pushing of course quite a bit on this out lap here and just see whether we are able to make an undercut work. We don't know. I think the gap to Jan Rotmeer once we pitted was roughly 1.8, 1.9 ish. I mean, that's quite a big gap. So I didn't expect this undercut to work, but why not give it a shot, right? So pushing very hard here in this lap, our out lap, which will be the in lap for Jan Rotmeer, because he will be stopping this lap, I reckon. And trying to respond to us. I don't know what Roy is going to do. You can see it on the minimap. Roy is actually staying out, so the leader is staying out. Jarno, indeed, you can see it on the minimap. He is going into the pit lane. We also need to have a look on our fuel. We're currently minus roughly 0.3 in terms of fuel. So somewhere during this race, we need to do some fuel saving, but that is not really going to be a problem, I reckon. Coming around the final chicane here. Very nice chicane, to be honest. Really getting a nice feeling once you go through there. Let's have a look then what it's going to be with Jarno. But actually, we might be able to pull this off. We'll see what happens here. Where is Jarno? Where is Jarno? There he is! Just in front of us. But that 1.9 second gap has completely vanished. And this is actually, you know, what I wanted to see. This is exactly what I wanted to see. Ah, but then a penalty. Well, let's take it. You know, it can happen once. Quite an easy track to make some cuts. So we'll accept it that we have a penalty right there. And then you see it here as well, the undercut is actually quite effective. Jarno also very close to Roy, also making the move on him. But of course, he was quite close to Roy. So, you know, once I pitted and I saw Jarno Rotmeer rejoining maybe 4-5 tenths in front of me, I was like, okay, we made up a 1.9 second gap. And I think that Jarno was closer to Roy than I was to Jarno when we pitted. So I thought that Jarno perhaps could have jumped Roy, but Roy probably having a good in-lap and staying ahead of Jarno. But, you know, this is really an encouraging sight when I saw this, because I was like, okay, we're now within DRS range. Maybe we can, you know, mix ourselves here with the top three and have a three-way fight for the lead. Our teammate, by the way, pay attention to him, currently 3.3 seconds behind us, and there are still plenty of laps to go in this race. In total there are 54 laps to go in this race, but you can see it already here visually. I'm having a bit of a hard time really keeping up with the top two again. We have got DRS, so that's good for us. The gap though is 0.997, so we're very, very close to losing the DRS. There is a backmarker in front of, or at least it's not a backmarker, is it? No, that's actually for position. That is the leader of the race who has not stopped yet, so he'll be driving on an old set of tires, probably being pretty slow. Let's see what we can do here. Let's see whether we can capitalize on this situation. But if we want to capitalize, we need to be closer than we are right now. You know, those 9 tenths we are behind Jarno, we really want to close that gap. But I was having a hard time doing that, to be honest. At the same time, though, I am saving fuel. You can see that, of course. But despite that, you know, I did feel like this, you know, these laps were pretty alright. They were pretty good. But I was still having a tough time keeping up with that top two, and here we go, making a move on Chris Drent, is the guy who is driving on that old set of Ultra Softs. Let's see what we can do. We of course want to get by Chris Drent as soon as possible. The DRS wide open, and also for Jarno, of course, he will probably be making a move into the chicane, and yes, he will. So now we need to be aware, because this will probably compromise Chris Drent's line through the chicane, which is dead. You saw how much we closed up under braking, overtake mode, rich mixture, DRS. And there we go. I don't think Chris Drent really is going to put up a fight there, and he is indeed not going to do that. So going through in third place, and now once again we start that process of trying to stick with the top two, but I couldn't. I simply could not. Their speed in this race was incredible. Not on that Hypersoft tire, but on the Ultrasoft tire. And this is again a phenomenon that we are seeing. First stint going very well. Very confident, able to save the tires, able to manage the tires. But then once you put a harder compound on, you know, that tire element, you know, it is still there, but it is not as important, not as effective as the first stint on that softest compound. So teammate then into the pit lane, we're seeing it here, lap 40 of the race. He's going for another stop. But honestly, we were driving in nobody's land at this point, so it's a very boring race. And Jarno, you see it there, has got a gap of 9.5 seconds or so. He made up 9.5 seconds within the space of, what is it, I think 26 laps. Yeah, 26. So that's quite extreme, of course, isn't it? You know, those 10 seconds. There was not really a way that I was gonna battle with that top two. And I noticed it, and once I noticed it, I was like, okay, fair enough. But the thing is, I think at this point we had something like 2 or 3 penalties, if I remember correctly. Maybe even 4. So, you know, considering it's 3 seconds additional time penalty per penalty, and we have got roughly 3 or 4 penalties perhaps, that would mean that we have got a time penalty of 9 or 12 seconds, something like that. Now, I know at this stage that Borders also has a 6-second time penalty, I believe. Because you can talk to the engineer and he will say how much time penalty the car behind or in front has. I believe Borders has got a 6-second penalty. And the gap is 6.8. So I was like, okay, that's not really the gap that I'm looking for. So my goal for the next 27 laps. Let's have a listen, by the way, because this is the section where the engineer is gonna say how much the penalty is from Borders. Here we go. Yeah, there we are. So it's 6 seconds, and I think we've got 3 or 4 time penalties worth 9 or 12 seconds. So having that gap to Borders being 6 seconds, 6.8, I wasn't exactly too confident with it. So I was pushing in the last 27 laps. In the end, the gap was 12 seconds, and I was like, okay, you know, that's enough. There we see it, 12.7 seconds. I was like, okay, you know, that's enough. I can now relax a little bit for these last 5 laps, drive it home, and that's really it. But you know, if I can say something really, that top two, their pace in the second and third stint, it's incredible. It's a consistent 2 or 3 laps every single lap, of course, that makes that gap. But I don't know where to find the time. I really do not know. I mean, you know, what I can do is practice a lot, because you know, I don't really want to practice a lot on this game. I don't feel like it's worth it. You know, I don't enjoy practicing. That's the thing as well. I don't enjoy practicing in this game. I enjoy the racing in this game. I enjoy it a lot, actually. But practicing, oh man, I mean, don't really like it. And then we have it, lap 65 of the race, another time penalty. And then I was like, okay, I don't know why, but there was a trigger in my mind that said, okay, that 12 second gap might not be enough. Let's push again the last 4 laps. Let's bring it up to 15, because obviously 12 plus 3 seconds is 15 seconds. Currently, the gap to Borders, 12.7 seconds. So I was like, okay, let's push a little bit again in the last 5 laps. Let's bring it up to 15. I was pretty sure that I was going to be safe with 12 seconds anyway. But, you know, you kind of want to keep yourself entertained almost a little bit during that race. You know, you want to set some goals, because if you don't do that, you know, you will drive in nobody's land, get bored, and a mistake then is easily made, you know. So you want to try to keep that focus a little bit, and I, you know, try to get that focus by, you know, doing this, try to get that gap to Borders to 15 seconds. It's currently 40.7. And this is the final lap of the race, so we'll see what we can do. But once again, that top two, you know, they drove extremely well, and I can actually tell you already, Jarno is going to win this race because of time penalties. Roy is leading, that's true, but I think Roy has got a few more penalties than Jarno has got, so Jarno will be the guy who takes home the victory and extend his gap in the championship as well. And honestly, you know, I need to take my hat off, but I don't know where to find that time. I really do not know. You know, maybe if I practice the whole day, I will somehow find some time, but that's not really in my blood, at least not for this game. And here we are then, through the final chicane, lap 70 of the race, and we're taking home a third place, and you know, it was the best that we could do. That first stint, we were quite close, quite good on the pace, but then that second and third stint, you know, was a bit tough, a bit rough, especially because of that top two, their pace, relentless pace really. And in the end, we finished 9 seconds ahead of Borders in the in the standing. So we had plenty of margin there as well. Bit of a boring race really after that first stint, but what can you do about it? We'll be going with our chin up into the next couple of rounds. And actually the next couple of rounds I think we can do quite well. Those are tracks that I do enjoy quite a bit. We'll see what happens though. Thanks all for watching once again, and I will see you next time. Take care, goodbye.